A suit is one of the few garments that you can actually alter the contour of someone's body. You can make them appear a completely different shape by using the art of tailoring, which, of course, you cannot do with a pair of skin-tight jeans. If you've got a terrible arse, it will be a terrible arse covered in denim.
When you started designing the suits, what did you do specifically about the jackets?
I suddenly started doing things that looked more American 40s. It's true that one does draw from things in the past, because you've got to get men to buy these things. And men are very conscious of buying things that are not, you know, they won't buy something if they're going to look a fool in front of their friends, or they think that. Mind you, when the penny drops, they might get sex out of it, then they'll have a whole different attitude. Women love a man in a suit. He can bring home the bacon. The suit indicates success, success, success. Women can take or leave sex, men can't. And they need that suit. If it's going to get them laid, they're going to buy that suit.
The classic framing of Anthony Price's suits for Brian Ferry was further sexed up by subtle but significant details. There's nothing feminized about this suit. The shoulders are defined, the torso's tapered, and by cutting away the front of the jacket, the crotch is all on show.
What I was doing in the 70s became commercial 80s, including that look that I'd done on Brian Ferry, which was the slim suit. He'd obviously worn it on television, so it had got around. And nobody dared wear that suit. It was almost 10 years, and it was 10 years before Duran Duran took it on board and said, I don't care who's worn it before, we love it, we're going to wear it. His suits were narrow, with quite narrow lapels. We did the turquoise and green and lilac suits, which were then strategically placed on a yacht in the then, you know, everyone aspired then to go to the Caribbean. And to see them splashing around in these suits with dyed yellow hair and what have you, against turquoise sea and azure blue sky, worked very well. And it's an iconic image from the 80s.
After a decade in the fashion doldrums, the suit started to become cool again during the 80s. Looking relaxed and luxurious, the right suit said you'd arrived. And it wasn't just Anthony Price who was making them. Just as in the 60s, Italian design was on the rise again.
Armani's really interesting. His whole attitude towards fashion, certainly the suit and menswear, has been about the feel and the touch of fabric. An Armani suit was cool, sexy, with that kind of slouchy style, epitomised by Richard Gere in American Gigolo. It's not for boys.
Isn't it a little late for you?
My husband's still in New York. I'm alone.
It's for men in their 30s who can afford it. You aspire to an Armani suit. Armani, you can pick up a suit and just put it on like that. Because they're easy to wear, they're comfortable, it's like wearing a cardigan.
Why did he do that?
Because it was new, and because it would sell.
In the 80s, an Armani suit became shorthand for success. For all of his subtle design innovations and emphasis on fabric, it was Armani's ability to create a desirable brand that made his suits entirely new. No need to mask, he's a smooth operator.
Smooth operator. Smooth operator. what Armani did that was so brilliant was to make it so international and to make the idea of his label so extremely desirable that was way and above the importance of the cut of that suit. He started off in 1975. By 1987, he had a $350 million turnover.
So the 80s brought the suit right back into fashion. Anthony Price's designs for Brian Ferry, the billowing silk numbers he did for Duran Duran, or think of Miami Vice and those louche, colourful suits worn with the sleeves rolled up. But it was here in the city that the evolution of the suit continued again. If you think about the power suit worn by the children of Thatcher, the people who worked here in the city, double-breasted, big-shouldered, big status symbols worn by the self-styled masters of the universe. This was the era when greed was good, and that became synonymous with what they wore. And of course, being a banker today, it's not such a popular profession, and I would love to know whether actually the suit is still something that's worn with pride here in the square mile of the city. I feel like in my quest to find the perfect suit, this is my Attenborough moment. I've hit the motherlode. This is the sort of watering hole of this species of men who wear suits as a matter of course. It's a natural thing. How long have you worked in the city?
Since 1980.
Since 1980?
Yeah.
So the 80s were quite a different time to be working
you
in the city.
You had to wear a suit. There was nothing, no other possibility.
So you, in those days, you were always in the suit?
Every day. It meant power. You know, if you were bold in what you wore, it meant you were powerful. It sent a signal.
It's interesting in that context that you don't wear a suit. Are you sort of gone underground? It's incognito. You don't want to be barracked.
It's not good to show, you know, that you're conspicuously an investment banker. Definitely not.
But isn't it important to be, when you're in the city, to kind of dress as other city people do?
Not unless you're meeting a client. You know, it's the impression you give to the client that's most important. So when they see you, they want to see you in a suit.
In the 90s, influenced by American trends from Silicon Valley, the dominance of the suit in the workplace was challenged by the smart but casual revolution. Dress down Friday had arrived.
I've done dress down Friday, and sometimes there might be something quite important going on, and I'm not switched on enough. I just feel like I'm an interloper, really, and not ready for work.
I feel better. I feel more able to perform somehow when I'm wearing a suit.
People coming in Bermuda shorts and T-shirts really didn't reflect well, and it seemed to encourage sloppy behaviour. So I think the conclusion was wearing a suit, you know, clothes to make it the man, a little bit of that was resonating, I think, within the industry.
Well, it's almost a uniform for work. It's where I feel most comfortable around the workplace. Dress like this.
Some people don't like it, but it's an easy way to dress. You don't have to think about it too much. You just get a suit, get a shirt, and get a tie, and you go to work.
Someone said to me a long time ago, don't dress for your job, dress for the job that you want, and you don't find the top brass wearing jeans and a T-shirt on Friday, do you?
It seems to me that the suit has come to a really interesting place. Without losing its essential qualities, it has evolved into something versatile that means many different things to many different men. And that subtle flexibility is the secret of its survival. It successfully straddles two worlds. It remains a uniform, making men feel ready for work, but it continues to fascinate designers, whose innovations ensure that, however subtle, the look of the lounge suit never stands still. I'm going to finish my voyage of suit discovery by meeting Britain's international king of menswear, Paul Smith.
Oh, it's perfect, sir.
God, this is bespoke service. Paul Smith began selling menswear from his first shop in Nottingham in 1970.
We do 26 collections a year.
The potentially boring combo of a jacket and trousers of matching cloth has helped build a glamorous empire that now exports to 56 countries around the world.
This is the design studio here. This is where we're working on the future collections.
Yeah. You're just like this whirlwind. I'm sort of trying to keep up, you know.
Sorry.
this is how it all works.
That's a suit that's got a knitted cuff, and that will have, you know, be slashed with some stitching.
I've never seen that before.
No.
A cuff like that.
Can't show them.
I think it's too late.
Oh, OK. Yeah. Anyway, this is where we create fabrics that are going to be printed. Often they'll get used as linings. So, for instance, you'll get a classic suit like you've got on.
Yeah.
And then it'll have probably a lining like this, so it'll be a completely classical suit. And then you'll get a bit of fun. We had the band Green Day, and they wanted some suits for the Mercury Awards. So we made them some suits, and then I photographed a mixing desk, and then that became the lining. So when they got the awards, the suit was just hanging out, so you just saw a bit of that. Since I was 18, I've been working with people like Led Zeppelin and Bowie and Jagger and now with Kaiser Chiefs, Franz Ferdinand, etc. So, amazingly, a lot of these young bands want to wear suits, but they don't want to wear a more formal suit, so they want a suit that's got a bit more of an unusual approach to it. So it'll be the way it's constructed or the fabric or the colour. And
do you think the suit will just endure forever?
I do, yeah, because it does a job. And it's you know, if you get into it, it's actually quite a nice thing to use.
What's the job? If you had to, like, boil it right down, what's the job a suit does?
Makes you feel good. Elegant, important, sexy, tall.
Do you think you'll ever become bored with the suit?
No, because I like to... I think that you can wear the suit in so many different ways, you know, with tennis shoes, a floral shirt, a chambre shirt, just a jacket. No, never. A good suit is almost like, you know, when you close a car door that's a nice car and it's got this sort of solid sound about it, or you have a knife and fork in your hand and it's got some weight about it. A good suit just has that solidity and that sort of importance about it that equals craftsmanship.
So I'm still in Paul's office. He's gone, complete dynamo of energy. And before he left, he allowed me to try on the full suit. And in fact, he chose the tie and he's done it up on me and everything. And it is quite amazing what it does. Where I think Paul's bang on is that a suit shouldn't be about all of the codes and the conventions, the number of buttons, the type of lapel, the vents, the drape, just for their own sake, as a ticket into high society. A suit should be about quality. It should be about making you feel confident, giving you stature, transforming you so that you can play the role, if you like, of being a man. This is part of the machinery still of the modern man, even 160 years after the lounge suit was first made. I just wish that I didn't have to give it back.
Coming up next here on BBC4, there's another case for our Swedish super sleuth, Wallander, in just a few moments. And Alistair's back tomorrow over on BBC1 as he unveils the world's most expensive paintings at 9.